So I'll just start with the questions. It's more on the side of recruiters than on the side of academician. We have most academicians sitting with us. First question to, let's start with Tamanna. You know, what are the challenges, you know, that you guys face? You're the co-founder of a baby destination and possibly also the recruiter of your employees. What are the challenges that you face, the skill gap, you know, that you see when you start hiring?
Thanks. So one of the biggest thing that we feel is missing is curiosity. So I feel like somehow everything is so preconditioned and we're so presupposed to what it should be that students are not asking questions. And that's sort of the beginning of everything, right? That's how innovation happens. That's how you think out of the box. So that's one of the biggest things that I would want to point out at. And not just here in India. Before this, I was in New York and I was in investment banking. And I used to take interviews there as well. There's a slight change between India and overseas. I feel India, it's a little bit more of a closed mindset.
The same question to you. Just a bit of context. Most companies today have training programs for fresh recruits, right? And that's possibly the reason because they want to train them. And the other reason is because they haven't been trained that well off in college. The challenges and the skill gaps you see and why those training methods then become important.
Simply, when we look at the new joinees coming and joining the Tata Power family, when we say that, we see some kind of business acumen is missing. And business acumen includes the financial acumen also and also the societal impact. Now when we join an organization, it is not that we are working for ourselves. We are working for the business, and business is working for a lot of customers, lot of stakeholders, and also the community or the society that it operates in. So when we look at the new joinees coming out of from campus, we definitely try to inculcate those kind of values that you have to be business conscious, financial viability of a business, of a business project, and at the same time you have to be conscious of the environment and the society that we operate in. And what Tamanna added, the curiosity, we call that agility, which is a kind of a flexibility and a proactive innovative approach. We have a training unit plan where we kind of try to inculcate these kind of values so that when they, after completion of the 1 year of the training unit program, they become wholesome professional, which are value creator, not for just themselves, but for the business and the community as well.
There are two major challenges as well, pointed out by experts. One is the side of general hardcore, you know, skills, which your education institution imparts. And the other side is the soft skills, which your parents have a role, the educational institution has a role, your society has a role. You know, adding to that, adding synergy to the same question, what challenges do you face? Is it the two elements play an important role?
Of course, you know, it's a holistic, cumulative effort of each, part of the society, whether it's our parents, or the largest cycle group, or educational institutes, or, corporate world for that matter. So I won't pinpoint one aspect where it has a major role, but it has to be a holistic approach. Having said that, in our society, it's not easy to define from what family background you come from. That variable will always remain. But when we are talking at the level of a B school, we are trying to have some standardization, right? We're trying to inculcate some common values, some common competencies. So there I feel the gap will get bridged further. And of course, when you move to the corporate world, again, you are trying to bridge that gap, and both sides have to work to bridge it. It's a symbiotic relationship. It's the corporate world and the B schools have to coexist and provide the best product possible.
See, pretty nice thoughts put here, Jacob. I would like to come to you next, and something which our audience would also want to know is that if you can put a percentage to the dearth, if there's a dearth of soft skills more, or is the dearth of hardcore curriculum inculcation in students, since you see it firsthand, what is it? Is it the skill gap which the colleges are not able to provide, or is it the soft skills which a student would develop over a period of time?
good afternoon, everyone. Pleasure to be here. Let me give you a broader perspective of this entire thing, you know, industry-ready students versus what is being taught in the management institutions. Let's look at the larger picture. I think Shiv presented in the morning that there are about 4,000 management institutes across the country. And let's take an average of about 350 to 400 students in each institute. So you multiply that by the number of institutes, look at the number of students who are wanting to get jobs after doing a two-year MBA. Most of the students would like to get into the top 20 or top 30 institutes. Can corporate India afford great jobs for all these 4,000 into 350 students which pass out? Not really. So the all the organizations which would like to get the best of candidates all try to get a slot day zero or day one in these top management institutes. Some of these students who cannot get into the top 20 or 30 institutes, some find a way to go abroad and look at, you know, either a Taiwan institute in that country or a reasonably good tier two institute. So with all of this happening, and I mean, we really don't have the kind of jobs that are required for the number of students that are passing out. So what really are the challenges that we face? One is, you still have some of these archaic case studies which are being taught. The updates are on the latest numbers. You use the same case study, but you just update the latest revenue or sales figures or the latest information. Contemporary research is not being done to a large extent by most of these institutes. Second is, are institutes helping students launch businesses? I mean, how many management institutes really help students launch businesses? How many institutes in India have an entrepreneurship fund which has been created to help students really look at entrepreneurship as, you know, as a, you know, as a way of life? The other thing is, an entrepreneurship course is normally taught in the last semester of the two-year program, which is certainly not enough. So how much is there a real-life stimulation to what is happening? And, you know, everybody talks about industry-academia collaboration, but let's face it, how many people from the industry are ready to leave their jobs when they are at the, you know, when they are at the helm of their careers? Like someone who are in the early 40s or 45, if you become the CEO or the CFO or whatever it is, you know, if you become that, are you ready to leave your job and give back to society by going back to a academic institution and teaching? Not really. And entrepreneurship in institutes, one thing which has to be taught is that there has to be delayed gratification. You cannot expect, if you're going to look at an entrepreneur and the institute helps you through, you know, through a course or through a mentor, saying that after 1 year you will have a great company, sales will grow by this much, you get so many, this will be a salary. No, it will only be delayed gratification. So I think it's a combination of various factors. You have to change mindset, you have to create an entrepreneurship fund. How many institutes are really helping students start new companies? I think these are the kind of things which are happening across the globe. And before, you know, one last thing that I'd like to say is, curriculum in a management institute will never give you the competitive edge. Now why? Just look at MIT. A few years back, they put the entire curriculum on the net for everybody to see. So everybody could actually see what is being taught. So I think curriculum is just one small aspect of teaching entrepreneurship or teaching students what they want to become in life. So I think if you think you're going to get an advantage through your curriculum, no. I think that's a given, you know. And I think, how are you going to attract people to come to your institute? What is the experience that you're going to give them in those 2 years that they're going to be there with you, or a 1 year working MBA program, or whatever? I think these are some of the factors that we in India need to really look at, because I think globally things are changing. Even in Southeast Asia, I mean, I live in Kuala Lumpur, you know, for the last 2 years I've been. Even in Southeast Asia, I think institutes such as the Asian Institute of Management are changing curriculum, changing student experiences based on the fact that they are attracting global faculty to come and be permanent in this institution to teach students what they have learned across the globe.
Great, thank you. Amit? Classroom to cabin is a very interesting theme, and I can't help but share this. As a student in a classroom many years back, it was my aspiration to get to a cabin. And by the time I got to a cabin, guess what? You know, the cabins are completely old fashioned. And believe me, I mean, nobody wants to get into a cabin today, because you know, the whole ecosystem within an office environment is so different today. I mean, you have more open communication, you have more access to people, you just walk in. So cabins are completely out of fashion, out of place. And the other important thing about classrooms being in fashion is equally important, because, you know, today continuous learning, I mean, the only survival skill of the future, as I was reading somewhere very appropriately, the only survival skill of the future is learning, lifelong learning. And if you have to withstand turbulent times, if you have to withstand change in business environment, in socio-economic environment, the only skill that will get you ahead today is lifelong learning, right? Which happens classroom in a figurative sense, but being lifelong learners wherever you are. So I think to Jacob's point, which was extremely well put by Jacob, it's long known at an individual level. I sense that as well. I graduated from the leading business school with postgraduate studies in human resources 2 decades back. And I could sense back then that our curriculum was not keeping pace with the evolutions and changes in the industry. You know, we were still studying industrial era sort of regulations, and we were still studying industrial era analysis, which just didn't seem right for the business environment and the dynamic challenges that one would be expected to face on the job. I mean, if you fast forward that to a digital era, I can only sense that the gap is probably multiplied even more, because the pace of change, let's say even the last couple of years, 3, 4, 5 years, has been much faster, much more rapid, and far, far more than it has been in the last 10 or 15 years. So I think keeping pace with changes in the industry environment, keeping pace with digital challenges of today, is probably the most important aspect of education, of curriculums, I think, that institutions have to take by
the dynamic nature.
How deep learning is relevant?
You just pinpoint one solution, each, everybody, as to how to bridge this gap. Just one solution with your context to it. We'll start from there.
So the solution is that, according to me, it starts from the get-go when the child is small. I have a 4-year-old, and there are a few things that I do day to day. I let him ask as many questions as he can. I always try to answer with the logic that I know, but then I listen to his answer and his out-of-the-box thinking. I encourage learning by observation in a real setting. So we do role plays even right now. I think if this all of these entrepreneurial skills, so-called, are inculcated from the get-go, because you may or may not do a startup, but even in your corporate life, what really matters is how entrepreneurial you are, how many net new projects you can undertake. So I just feel the solution is that from the get-go, inculcating the culture of being able to think out of the box, not putting them in boxes, and encouraging problem solving.
Thank you. I think it is the joint responsibility of the corporate and the academia both to create value for the future. I encourage to have more and more industry-academia collaboration. And I have seen some of the very promising B-schools or the universities coming forward. In addition to encouraging their students to do some kind of business projects, they are now sending their faculties and professors to understand the business first. Now, you see, if the professors who are teaching these students, if they know the business challenges, they will definitely try to inculcate those kind of skills in those students, that they can create better value for themselves and for the business. So I encourage more of industry-academia collaboration in this case.
So I'll echo his thoughts and just probably add on to it. I think you win the real battle when you are in the battlefield, right? And it will be good if we expose our students with snippets of the real-time experience during the academic years. So maybe a built-in program, semester-wise, for them to have a real-time experience in the corporate world. Something other than summer internship, maybe a field project. Something on those lines is what I will encourage you to be a part of the academic curriculum.
As I said, one of the USPs or your competitive advantage in a B-school is your competitive faculty, the skill sets of the faculty that you have, apart from many of the other things that we spoke about. So I think what we need to look at is, just a simple example, why are some of the advanced management programs the most wanted, or everybody wants to go there? Because they would like to hear faculty like Vijay Govindarajan or some of the other professors in various institutes talk about their experiences, about what they're doing in innovation. So I think that's what makes the difference. The faculty, can we get global faculty to our Indian schools?